We have a large camel spider on the road down here, and it is eating a lizard. And I believe it caught this lizard within the last minute.
It looks like I spooked the camel spider, and now it's running away.
The camel spider has settled back down, and you can tell that they make very quick work of their prey. When we were just looking at it on the asphalt, we could see approximately half of the body of the lizard, and now it's mostly just the head that's left. If you're wondering which species of lizard it's feeding on, that would be Coleonyx variegatus, otherwise known as the western banded gecko. In my experience, in this area, it's the most common species of nocturnal lizard. The one that this camel spider is eating is just a juvenile, and at this size, they normally look something like this. This is a juvenile western banded gecko that is slightly smaller than the one that the camel spider here is eating. But regardless, this is basically the way the one that the camel spider is eating looked before it got caught. But these camel spiders are very likely capable of taking down adult geckos too. And the reason I say this is because just the other night, I saw a camel spider with an ornate tree lizard in its mouth, known scientifically as Urosaurus ornatus. And a few things about that lizard. It's much tougher than the gecko that our camel spider is feeding on, but it's also diurnal, which means that the camel spider found it in a crack somewhere and then pulled it out and managed to carry it out on the underside of that rock without falling down for a few minutes. Camel spiders are quite well known for the manner in which they consume their prey. They have two sets of chelicerae, making up for four individuals in total, and both pairs move in separate directions to create a scissoring motion, and with their sharp denticles or teeth, that's how they're able to tear apart their prey. Camel spiders aren't venomous, so their process of consuming prey is purely mechanical. I mentioned that I think that this camel spider just caught this gecko, and the reason for that is we can already see the rate at which it can consume this gecko, which means that it couldn't have been too long before I found it. But in addition to this, these western banded geckos autotomize their tail, or drop their tail, and this is a method of distracting predators, in which the tail that detaches from the body starts to wiggle around. This works mostly for predators that go off of sight, but in this case it's very ineffective against camel spiders. And that tail is still moving right now. And while these autotomized tails can move around for quite a long time, usually it only lasts the first couple minutes before then needing to be provoked yet again for it to continue wiggling. Last thing I should mention, these are the largest camel spiders in this state. The species is Eremocosta striata. And it, along with maybe one other species of camel spider, is likely one of the only species found in Arizona that can feed on reptiles. Now the camel spider seems to be done eating, and all that's left of the lizard is just a mass containing no identifiable parts. This camel spider probably isn't going to eat anymore, but I am going to leave it alone next to its ball of meat just in case it wants to eat it later. That whole clip that you just saw was filmed approximately a year ago, and I thought I would make a full-length video out of it. So I am back in southern Arizona tonight, and we are going to look for a couple more of these camel spiders, hopefully adults. Since we're unlikely to see maximum-sized individuals tonight, I know some people might have the urge to say in the comments that they've seen larger ones. Don't worry, I have too. They're just more difficult to come by. We have a Pleotomus nigropennis crawling around on the ground down here. And that is a species of glowworm. And I usually don't film glowworms. In fact, I never have on this channel. But the reason I'm filming this one is because it's quite large, as you can see. This one is the largest species of glowworm that I've ever seen, though it isn't the first time with this species specifically. You can see this one is moving around a little bit right now, but as soon as I take it, it will feign death. The interesting thing about these is that when they play dead, they can retract their head into the thorax. This glowworm, like many others, is the female of a firefly, and it does have the ability to emit light, though we're probably not going to see this one do that. And unlike the males, which look like normal beetles, this larva form female is actually an adult. But like many female fireflies, they are neotenic. And there's a range of neoteny represented in the superfamily Elateroidea, which these beetles belong to. And to my knowledge, the superfamily generally contains the greatest sexual dimorphism that you can find in beetles. But while this female is larva form, and possibly the closest beetles have ever gotten to hemimetabolism, they still do pass through a pupal stage. But as you might guess, the six larval instars look very similar to the female that we have here. We have a tiger rattlesnake right here. Then right over here, there's another tiger rattlesnake. And let's see, oh, here is a black-tailed rattlesnake, a species that has been showcased on the channel before. And it's quite possible that these two rattlesnakes, the tiger rattlesnakes I mean, were in combat. I was lucky enough to observe this quite recently
in an area within the same mountain range. As for the black-tailed rattlesnake that's up there, that's completely unrelated. Here's that first rattlesnake again. I would stay longer to talk about them a little bit, but I'm more interested in coming back later to see if they're back in combat, or perhaps they weren't ever in the first place and they're about to. So I'll give it another hour before I'm back. Up here, behind this rock, there's a ring-tailed cat. I promise. There it is. And this is Bassariscus astutus. This one's within 10 meters of where I'm standing. I've been seeing a lot of these lately, actually. In fact, so much so that I was lucky enough to run into a pair of these ring-tailed cats. And they weren't too far away from me either. Quite unsurprisingly, I had never seen a pair of ring-tailed cats before that point. What's really nice about these is, no matter what the conditions of the night are, there's still a chance of seeing one or two.
We have our first Eremocosta striata of the night here, and this one is a male.
These live in south central Arizona and through Sonora, Mexico, but beyond that, their distribution is a little bit ambiguous. And this is a species that I encounter most often in saguaro-dominated low deserts. But they live in a range of altitudes, and therefore in a range of habitats as well, and some of the other ones include oak woodland and mesquite savannas. This species of camel spider is predominantly active from late June to late August, but the tail end of that season varies quite a bit from year to year, and this is mainly dependent on the monsoon season. However, during this period, they will emerge on fairly dry nights, but also just after rains. Regarding this activity period for this species, there seems to be a bit of temporal partitioning between Eremocosta and another genus known as Eremorhax. As a genus, Eremorhax are the second largest camel spiders out here, and they are active in the spring and early summer, and their activity period stops right when that of Eremocosta starts. It's potentially the only other genus in Arizona that may be capable of feeding on lizards. But one reason this might not be true temporal partitioning is because both of these genera represent generalist species with fairly unremarkable diets that you wouldn't expect to require partitioning. We might cross off a substantial number of common classic species that live out here. This is the Sonoran Desert Millipede, Orthoporus ornatus. This millipede that we have here is the heaviest species that can be found around here, though I must say that there's not much competition because the millipede diversity locally is not super high. These millipedes can also attain lengths of over 15 centimeters, so the one that we have here definitely has a lot more growing to do. One of the things that this species is fairly well known for is ranging from nearly black to a kind of golden color, but these morphotypes depend on the region, and those golden ones can't be found around here. These are found in Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Oklahoma, and Mexico, and they've been found to have a preference for areas with high plant diversity, but not necessarily dense plant cover. They feed on detritus, or soil, and also on the surface tissues of desert shrubs. A 1973 paper found that their diet, plus their abundance among a few other things, makes them quite important nutrient cyclers in the desert, and it's possible that, in some instances, these are a keystone species. Have a Lampropeltis intergrade here. This kingsnake is an intergrade between the California kingsnake and the desert kingsnake. That would be Lampropeltis californiae and splendida. And this intergrade is something that's found in and around the Tucson Basin. But the one that we have here definitely leans more towards the desert kingsnake. But I have seen superficially pure-looking Lampropeltis californiae not too far away from here as well. If we were looking at a kingsnake that was more genetically true to a Lampropeltis splendida, it would likely be much more speckled than the one that we have here, though of course there are exceptions to that. Conversely, if this was getting genetically closer to Lampropeltis californiae, we would see clearer bands, especially ones lighter in color. Those two Lampropeltis are the most widespread and common species in the state, with the desert kingsnake being second to the California kingsnake. I think part of the reason for that is the desert kingsnake has a lower upper altitudinal limit. Oftentimes, when you are targeting a certain species, you can do things that will maximize your chances of finding said species by looking in specific habitats or going out and searching under certain conditions. But with these camel spiders, as long as you're within the monsoon period, there's not much more you can do than that. They don't seem to have a preference for a certain microhabitat or anything. You just have to walk and keep walking. We have a mature male Arizona blonde tarantula down here, and I've seen many hundreds of these at this point, but I thought I would finally film one. This one's a little bit on the small end.
If you don't already know, the females look quite a bit different than these males, and they're actually the reason why these are called Arizona blonde tarantulas, as they are quite a bit lighter than the males, though the prosoma is quite light on these males as well. Despite being such a ubiquitous tarantula species almost statewide, in the United States, these are highly restricted to Arizona, but not completely. And unsurprisingly, the majority of the rest of their population is in Sonora, Mexico. Like some other larger Aphonopelma species, these Aphonopelma chalcodes can sometimes be encountered in urban areas. The larger high elevation Aphonopelma in Arizona plus Aphonopelma voorheesi form one clade, and all of the dwarf species also form another clade. But this Arizona blonde tarantula does not belong to either of these clades. It's in its own clade with the desert tarantula, Johnny Cash's tarantula, and the California ebony tarantula, which means that the closest relatives to this tarantula here are all the way in Utah, Nevada, or California. I recently crossed that area where we found two Crotalus tigris and one molossus, and no one was left. But here is another Crotalus tigris. This one is fairly pink. And I thought we would talk about the battling behavior between the two males while looking at this one. The two male tiger rattlesnakes that I saw battling each other were at the base of some mountains not too far away from here. And it wasn't me who spotted them. Someone else was nice enough to show them to me. This fighting between males occurs when both of them are tracking down a female and they get too close to one another. But to be clear, this doesn't always result in a fight between the two snakes. The method that's at play here, which involves raising the front part of the body, is knocking down the opponent. And during this process, there's a lot of hissing that goes on. I watched these two for about 10 minutes before leaving, but it can last much longer than that, and also much shorter than that. Sometimes only a minute, and even as long as half an hour. And in this case, as you might have guessed already, sexual selection does favor the larger snake in the battle. I was saying that two snakes encountering each other doesn't necessarily mean that a fight will break out. This is especially true when one of the snakes is much larger than the other, and in that case, the larger snake just chases the little one away. Because these are the most common rattlesnake species in this habitat, I will give these snakes a proper segment at some point in the future. Looks like it is on its way now, so I'll let it be at this point. This is somewhat uncommon. Our next camel spider here, which is this female, is sitting still. A little bit about the genus Arimacosta. It was described in 1934, but this species, Arimacosta striata, predates that and was described in 1883. It's a moderately speciose genus, at least for camel spiders, containing 14 species total. As I've stated previously, these are the largest camel spiders that you can find in Arizona, but these are also the largest camel spiders in all of the Americas. Their distribution as a genus is the southwest of the United States and northern Mexico. There's another species of Arimacosta that can be found in Arizona, and that is Arimacosta calexicensis, and it's also found in the borderlands. I believe that species has been on this channel previously. It is possible that that species gets a little bit larger than the one that we have here. And while this species tends to live in rocky areas or in areas with a lot of clay soil, Arimacosta calexicensis is a samophile. And this camel spider has deposited a purple poo on the ground. I can't say that I've ever seen this before. I'm not sure what would cause that. I get the sense that this camel spider might be lactose intolerant. We have an Anaxyrus punctatus toad down here on the ground. Gotta be gentle so it doesn't lose its water reserve. These are called red-spotted toads, but not all of them have red spots. The one that we have here is quite pallid,
compared to most of the ones that I see around here. But as juveniles, their red spots are more saturated and concentrated. This is the toad that I have encountered the most times in Arizona. It's quite a hardy species that seems to be more resistant to low humidity and heat than St. Patrick anurans. This one is an adult, and these adults are by far nocturnal, but the really small juveniles, around a centimeter or so in length, tend to be far more diurnal. And this daytime activity takes place around riverbeds and humid, shaded places in general. Given the proper conditions, these toads can be found pretty much year-round. In areas with no permanent water access, these tend to rely on ephemeral pools, especially during spawning season. This is not a very long-lived species. It has a lifespan average of about 2 years in the wild, and this might be due to its largely unrestricted activity periods. Well, that will be all for this video of looking for Arimacosta striata camel spiders in southern Arizona. So I hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.